Come every soul by sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord, and he will surely give you rest by trusting in his word. Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him now. He will save you, he will save you, he will save you now. For Jesus shed his precious blood, rich blessings to bestow. Plunge now into the crimson flood that washes white as snow. Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him now. He will save you, he will save you, he will save you now. Yes, Jesus is the truth, the way that leads you into rest. Believe in him without delay, and you are fully blessed. Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him now. He will save you.
Friends, good to be with you again in Coleraine Independent Methodist Church, and we're going to read the scriptures this evening from Mark's Gospel, chapter 10. Mark's Gospel, chapter 10, and we begin at verse 17. And when Jesus was gone forth into the way, there came one running and kneeled to him and asked him, "Good Master, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said unto him, "Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is, God. Thou knowest the commandments. Do not commit adultery, do not kill, do not steal, do not bear false witness, defraud not, honor thy father and mother." And he answered and said unto him, "Master, all these have I observed from my youth." Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him, and said unto him, "One thing thou lackest. Go thy way, sell whatsoever thou hast, and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven. And come, take up the cross, and follow me." And he was sad at that saying, and went away grieved, for he had great possessions. And Jesus looked round about, and saith unto his disciples, "How hardly shall they that have riches enter into the kingdom of God?" And the disciples were astonished at his words. But Jesus answereth again and saith unto them, "Children, how hard it is for them that trust in riches to enter into the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God." And they were astonished out of measure, saying among themselves, "Who then can be saved?" And Jesus, looking upon them, saith, "With men it is impossible, but with God, but not with God, for with God all things are possible." God will bless the public reading of the scriptures of truth. This young man who's brought before us by the various gospel writers, by Matthew in chapter 19 and by Luke in chapter 18, he has become known as the rich young ruler. We know that he was a young man, but he was rich. In the various records of Matthew and Mark and Luke make that clear. And I want us to look at him tonight and the encounter, the tremendously privileged encounter that he had with the Lord Jesus Christ. The first thing we need to look at is the life he lived. The life he lived. When the Lord Jesus talked to him about the necessity of keeping the commandments, he said this, "All these have I observed from my youth." Now that statement that he made wasn't a boast, but it was really a statement that outlined the kind of life he had lived, the way he had been brought up. I've looked at that in three ways. The principles that he was taught. It would seem that this young man was brought up in a very religious Jewish home. He'd been taught the commandments, taught the importance of obeying them. You know, people today have a view that the commandments are a set of restrictions. They're not. God gave men the commandments so that we might have a guide, if you like, a roadmap to steer us through life's journey. And he was taught the great principles of the Old Testament scriptures. And no doubt he had heard about the Lord Jesus and what he was doing, his claims to be the Son of God. And he has healed the sick and made the deaf to hear and the dumb to speak. He has seen and he had heard all these things. And now he wanted again to meet the Lord Jesus. The principles he was taught. Then I believe, secondly, there were the practices that he treasured. I believe this is a young man, and you'd have seen him in the synagogue every Sabbath day. And there he would have listened to preaching from the Old Testament scriptures, and this would have confirmed him in what he regarded as his faith and in the principles that he had been taught. I remember many years ago working with a man, and he wasn't a Christian. He and I became friends. And he told me this. He told me the church he went to, I was acquainted with the minister there, knew he was a man of God, but I didn't know him intimately. But he said, he's a great preacher, and he preaches the gospel. Now, John wasn't saved. But he said this to me. He said, I love being in church. I love singing the hymns. I love the public reading of the scriptures. I love to hear a good message. He loved all the things that a Christian should love. But yet he wasn't saved. There were practices that he treasured, but he had never come to that moment of putting his full trust and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. But there's another thing in this life that he lived, not just the principles he was taught and the practices he treasured. There was the prosperity he trusted. It said he went away grieved. We'll come to that in a few moments, for he had great possessions. And the Lord Jesus sensed that it was his possessions that he trusted in, because he said how difficult it is for they that have riches to enter into the kingdom of God. He trusted in his prosperity. Surely the life he lived and the things he loved and the prosperity he enjoyed, that was good enough. But it wasn't. You see, my dear friends, the Lord Jesus said, what should it profit a man if he gain the whole world and loses his own soul? I want you to come with me then, secondly, from the life he lived to the secret he sought. That is made clear in the question that he asked the Lord Jesus in the very first verse of the narrative that we read. Good Master, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life? Now that indicates something to us, that there was something for all the favorable elements of the life that he lived, there was something that was missing. Sometimes we sing a hymn, now none but Christ can satisfy, none other name for me, there's love and life and lasting joy, Lord Jesus, found in thee. And he sought the secret of eternal life. It's the question in life, because it concerns death. It's a question for now, because it concerns hereafter, eternity. The very fact that he calls it eternal life, he knew there was an eternity that ultimately we must all face. I want you to look at some things about him. The manner that he showed. I believe that it says that he came running. He was so anxious and he was so sincere in his desire that he actually came running. This was a young man, excuse me, who probably, he would have just, in a sense, we would have said he was sailing through life without a care in the world. And yet, there was a sense of urgency within him. The manner, there was an urgency in it, he came running. There was sincerity, because he actually bowed down before the Lord Jesus. It says he kneeled to him. And he took the place of a suppliant, a supplicant. He said, good master, what shall I do? He even addressed him as good master. There was sincerity, I believe, and there's humility because he need. There was so much about his manner that said something about him. You know, my dear friend, it's wonderful when people are sincere. But sometimes people can be sincerely wrong. I meet people regularly and they think that because they live a good life and society would be better if everybody did live a good life and because they seek to do good and they give into their church that, and they're sincere in their belief and they feel that that will fit them for heaven. But you know, my dear friends, Augustus Toplady wrote a great hymn, nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. And sincerity, while it may be a commendable attribute in the life of any man or woman, we can be sincerely wrong. It's what we're sincere about, and it's the object of our faith that is important. Because the faith of a Christian rests on the character of God and on the finished work of Christ. So it wasn't just the manner that he showed, but there was a misunderstanding in his asking. What do I mean by that? He said, what must I do? The implication there was, there's something that I have to do to inherit eternal life. And in eternal life isn't something we inherit, it's something that we receive as the free gift of God. The gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. My dear friends, the secret he sought is well known now, because it was after this encounter that the Lord Jesus reached the end of his earthly ministry. And there on the cross at Calvary, he gave his life a ransom for many. And there he purchased eternal life. Let me read this verse to you. Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse 9, ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich. The Lord Jesus left the splendor of heaven. A hymn writer puts it like this, out of the ivory palaces into a world of woe, only his great eternal love made my Saviour go. Remember that Nicodemus sought the secret of eternal life. The Queen of Sheba in the Old Testament sought the secret. She came to prove Solomon with hard questions, and Solomon gave her all her desire. And you see, the Lord Jesus could have filled the desire of this young man's heart if only he had been willing to trust him and yield to him. Remember the Philippian jailer, having very roughly cast Paul and Silas into prison. He almost kicked them into the cell. And when there's an earthquake and it seemed that everything is going to be falling down around him, he says, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And you see, my dear friends, That was the secret that this young man sought. The life he lived, the secret he sought. I want you to look thirdly at the response he received. It says this, Jesus, beholding him, loved him, and said, there's one thing that you lack. Go your way and sell whatever you have, and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven. And come, take up the cross, and follow me. Now, there's some people draw an erroneous doctrine from this. They say, there it is. You give to the poor, and you'll have treasure in heaven. But the Lord Jesus didn't mean that at all. What the Lord Jesus was saying, in spite of all the great attributes of your life that you feel very self-satisfied with, one thing you lack. One thing thou lackest. And the one thing that he lacked was just simple faith in the person of the Lord Jesus to be his Savior and to take away his sin. The word that he heard, whatever you have, give to the poor, and you'll have treasure in heaven. And come, take up the cross. Here the Lord Jesus introduces him, if you like, to the cross. You see, he left all the splendor of heaven. Yet he knew on a cross he would die. Yet, compelled by a love transcending, he was born to be crucified. The word he heard. I'm sure many listening to this gospel message this evening have heard the word of life. Many have been brought up in an evangelical church. They've had a godly Sunday school teacher. They have known from a child the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make us wise unto salvation. It was said of Felix, as Paul reasoned with him, that he had more perfect knowledge of that way. His wife was a Jewess, so he knew about the Messiah who would come to be the Savior of the world. And yet, my dear friends, the word that we hear has to be mixed with faith in those that hear the word. And you see, it's the entrance of God's word that gives light. It's the word of God that is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. It's totally different from the vain philosophies of man. And if you've heard the word of God, then you need to receive with meekness the engrafted word that is able to save your soul. The word he heard, the way he was loved. There's a lovely phrase in this. Jesus, beholding him, loved him. I want to tell you, my dear friends, this evening that although God is depicted in the Scriptures as a God of truth and a God of judgment, he's a God of love. John 3:16, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Tonight you might still be unsaved, but I want to tell you, you're not unloved. And Jesus looked at this young man, and it says, he loved him. We have a lovely hymn that says, I found a friend, oh such a friend. He loved me ere I knew him. He drew me with the cords of love, and thus he bound me to him. Jesus, beholding him, loved him. Do you know, my dear friends, as God looks into your heart and mine, he sees the sin that is there, and yet he loves us just the same. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, Paul tells us. The word he heard, the way he was loved, the witness he saw, Christ. The writer to the Hebrews said, God, who at sundry times and in different manners spake unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. Here is the Lord Jesus Christ, God incarnate, God incarnate, deity made flesh, dwelling among us. And he's standing there face to face with the Lord Jesus Christ, Emmanuel, God with us. And you see, my friends, the Lord Jesus, he said several times in his earthly ministry, he said, the men of Nineveh will rise up in judgment with this generation because they repented at the preaching of Jonah. And behold, a greater than Jonah is here. Here was God manifest in flesh, the Christ, the Messiah, the sent one of God. And here's the witness that he sees. Surely this should have persuaded him to open his heart and receive Christ as his Savior and Lord. But you know, we can tell that there was a calculation going on in his mind, because it said he went away grieved because he had great possessions. Maybe he was doing the sums in his mind and thinking there was a cost, there was a price he couldn't pay. You see, my dear friends, it was Warren Wiersbe, a great preacher and a writer of spiritual books. He said, calculation and crucifixion do not agree. At Calvary, there was no calculation or bargaining. It was just Jesus Christ giving his all. The response he received. And then I want you to look at the mistake he made. The Lord Jesus had given him that word. He had no doubt seen the love in the eyes of the Lord Jesus as he looked at him. He did realize that this was the Christ whom he was standing before. And yet he says he was sad at that saying. You know, when John wrote his letter, he said, these things have I written unto you, that your joy might be full. Among the children, we used to sing a wee chorus. If you want joy, real joy, wonderful joy, let Jesus come into your heart. You see, my dear friends, that at his right hand, there is fullness of joy and pleasures forevermore. He went away sad and grieved, for he had great possessions. He had knowledge of the way of salvation. He had sincerity to believe the message. He had a desire for eternal life. He had an opportunity, a golden opportunity right before his eyes. And yet, he made a mistake. He went away. He could have said simply, Jesus, I will trust thee. Trust thee with my soul, guilty, lost, and helpless. Thou canst make me whole. But he went away. Sometimes people will talk to us and they'll review certain things in their lives. And sometimes they will say this, you know, that was the biggest mistake I ever made. This was the biggest mistake that this young man ever made. Good life and all that he lived, like every man born, he had committed sins, he had made mistakes, but this was the greatest. You know, my dear friends, sometimes we can't see what's sitting in front of us, and this young man failed to see that this was the opportunity to get right with God and put his trust in Christ. Felix had that opportunity. We referred to him when Paul spoke to him of righteousness and self-control and judgment to come. It says he trembled. And then he says, go away for this time. When it's convenient, I'll call for you again. But you know, the scripture does not record a convenient season when Felix had opportunity to trust the Lord, because he didn't. Agrippa, when Paul gave his testimony before him, King Agrippa, he says, Paul, you almost persuade me to be a Christian. But there's a hymn in our book which says, almost persuaded but lost. The scripture would ask us, how long halt ye between two opinions? Maybe you have come to other points in your life where you felt that you needed to open your heart and receive the Savior, but you didn't. Not tonight, I'll get saved some other time. And as you listen to the message this evening, that opportunity represents itself again to you. Paul spoke to Timothy about those who trust in uncertain riches. Now let me make something clear. This young man was not lost because he had riches. He was lost because he trusted in his riches. You know, one of the saddest stories in the Bible is the story of Lot and his wife. As God judged Sodom for the sin of homosexuality, and he destroyed it, and Lot and his wife were told to flee. And Lot's wife looked back, and she became a pillar of salt. Now you say that was harsh judgment. No, it wasn't. That backward look that Lot's wife gave told us something about her. Her heart was still in Sodom. Never mind all the iniquity and evil that she'd seen there. Lot was even going to give his daughters to a vain homosexual mob. And that's the situation that she was in. And God was delivering her out of it. And she looked back because her heart still longed to be there. Because the Bible tells us where our treasure is, there will our heart be also. And that's why she perished. It wasn't just a wee backward glance. Just one look for the last time. No. That look said, that's where my heart is. That's where we made a good living. Now it's gone. You see, my dear friends, he went away grieved. Paul talked in his letter to the Galatians about the offense of the cross. Maybe he thought at an offense that he should have to leave the lifestyle he had. What the Lord Jesus was not saying to him was that you have to give to the poor to get eternal life. No, what he was saying to him is this: look, there are certain things that have a hold of your heart and you must break with them. Sometimes people will say to me, if I got saved, would I have to stop going to that place? Would I have to give up this or that? Sometimes that rings warning bells with me. Because really, when a man or woman are convicted of their sin and know that they need to receive Christ as their Savior, that's what they want to do. Nothing matters. And he came with that desire in his heart. What must I do to inherit eternal life? And the Lord made it clear that you didn't inherit it and you didn't have anything to do. He just said, you need to break with your past life and trust me. Remember, he came to Matthew, the Lord Jesus did, sitting at the receipt of custom, and said, follow me. And he left all and followed him. And Peter left, and Andrew left their fishing boats and came and followed the Lord. He went away, the greatest mistake of his life. And so this young man goes from the pages of Scripture the same way as he entered them, unrepentant, unsaved, still without in his heart that gift of God which is eternal life, and his feet still on the broad road that leads to destruction. Just in closing, the Redeemer he rejected. The Lord Jesus, it was just a short while later that he went to the cross and there laid down his life and shed his blood that men and women might be saved. And it was only a step to Jesus. In fact, he was right there. He was right there physically beside him in nearness. But spiritually, he was still afar off. Do you know what the Bible tells us? That we who were afar off can be made nigh or brought near by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. May you learn the lessons of this young man and do not make the mistake that he made. The thing is, he was still sad. If he had trusted Christ, it would have said he was glad at that saying and received Christ to be his Savior. But he went away sad. The children sometimes sing a chorus about the woman at the well who trusted the Lord Jesus. She went away, happy and glad, back to her home, never more to roam, because she found the living water, which was not down at the bottom of the well. May you put your trust in our Lord Jesus Christ, and may God bless the preaching of this simple gospel message for his glory. Amen.